Reincarnation. The idea that we return to another body after the death of our current body has fascinated humanity since the beginning of time. It raises arresting questions.
What is life? What is consciousness?
Is there a biological base of consciousness?
It's the kind of question that we cannot address from a scientific point of view.
Is birth really the beginning?
It's one of the more difficult questions from a scientific or a philosophical standpoint.
Is death truly the end?
Presumably, everyone has had past lives.
New discoveries from the frontiers of consciousness studies.
You cannot reduce mind consciousness to brain activity.
Near-death experiences.
Consciousness separates from the body and goes over the body.
And past life memories research.
There is some entity that carries on.
Are shedding new light on the way we look at life. Science today is witnessing a paradigm shift.
The paradigm shift is going to affect us in a major, major way.
New alternative explanations are emerging.
Science is really good at experiments and theory development, and marry that with the mystical experience, we'll develop a whole new civilization.
Could it be that now, finally, we are closer to understanding the timeless mysteries of life, death, and reincarnation?
That point of me dying on that hospital bed.
That's where everything kind of changed.
I entered another state of incredible clarity.
It was really beautiful.
Time is so strange in the other realm.
Time had almost stood still.
As soon as I made the decision to come back.
Today I'm grateful that this accident happened to me.
It's dark, it's frightening. And then they see the small light, they're attracted to it.
This is a paradox that I've not been able to resolve, I have not been found a solution to.
The phenomenon of people dying and returning to life to tell their tales in the afterlife has been a recurring theme in the ancient literature of many cultures, from the Greeks to the Utracians to the Old Norse. But how do we perceive incidents of near-death experiences today? According to a recent study, around 15 million Americans have had a near-death experience. 3.3 million Germans have had a near-death experience. 2 million cases have been acknowledged in France. With similar statistical figures around the world, a growing body of evidence suggests that this widespread phenomenon should not be dismissed as merely myth or legend. Near-death experiences are often used dramatically in the arts to great emotional effect. But in day-to-day life, such occurrences create a lot of questions. Questions that are crucial in furthering our understanding of the phenomenon we call life. How does the science of our times validate such incidents? How does it explain them? Is it really possible for a person to remain conscious when medically unconscious, or even proclaimed dead? In 1969, Dutch cardiologist and scientist Dr. Pim van Lommel, then a young cardiology intern, witnessed an unconscious cardiac arrest patient being revived after nearly 4 minutes of complete absence of life.
We resuscitated him successfully, so after a spell of about 4 minutes of unconsciousness, he regained consciousness, and we as a resuscitation team, and I was attending doctor, we were very, very happy. The patient was extremely disappointed, and he told me about a tunnel and a light and a beautiful colors, a beautiful landscape. And I never forgot this event, but I never didn't do anything with it.
In the years that followed, Dr. Lommel worked at the Rheinstadt Hospital Arnhem, where he was confronted with death almost every day. Although he had never forgotten the 1969 experience, he didn't do anything about it. But this changed in 1986, after he read a book about near-death experience by George Ritchie called Return from Tomorrow.
And that was the moment that my scientific curiosity started to grow, because according to our current medical knowledge, it is not possible to experience consciousness, let alone enhanced consciousness, when you have a cardiac arrest, when you're unconscious because there's no breathing, no heartbeat, no blood pressure. So that was the reason that we started with some other scientists a prospective study in the Netherlands. We had 344 consecutive patients who survived cardiac arrest in 10 Dutch hospitals. We had a first interview within several days of resuscitation, as soon as they were more able to respond to our questions. And we found that 18% of those patients who survived cardiac arrest had memories of a period of unconsciousness, who had a near-death experience.
What exactly is a near-death experience? Or rather, what happens during an NDE? I saw beautiful landscapes. I saw extraordinarily beautiful colors. Peace, calmness. No pain. Unconditional love. A tunnel. A beam of light. A feeling of lightness. I met my father. I heard music. I saw my relatives in another country. I saw and heard what the doctors were doing. I was floating. These are the words and descriptions given by emotionally charged patients after their near-death experience. In the absence of any scientific structure with respect to near-death experiences and out-of-body experiences, it has been a challenge to validate these experiences. Improved survival rates because of modern techniques and resuscitation have led to more and more people coming out and sharing detailed accounts of their experiences. The absence of a frame of reference for these experiences, as well as their subjective nature, has led bold researchers to look beyond the obvious and question the very basics of our understanding about how science views such phenomena. Apart from individual researchers, organizations like IANS, the International Association of Near-Death Studies, and NDERF, the Near-Death Experience Research Foundation, have extensively documented thousands of cases from around the world.
I've received near-death experiences from all around the world in literally several dozen different languages. One thing that is very clear to me as a near-death experience researcher is that it doesn't seem to make any difference whether you're, say, a Hindu in India or a Muslim in Egypt or a Christian in the United States. Wherever you are in the world, you can have a near-death experience, and the content of that near-death experience will be strikingly similar wherever on the planet you are.
In the year 2001, the much-acclaimed medical journal The Lancet published Near-Death Experience in Survivors of Cardiac Arrest, a prospective study in the Netherlands by Dr. Pim van Lommel. It took the medical world by storm. Never before had such a systematic study been conducted into the experiences of people who were declared dead and then brought back to life. And never before have we seen such a clear illustration of how these people's stories could affect our way of thinking about life and death.
We did the prospective study and the longitudinal study in the Netherlands in 10 Dutch hospitals, which took 10 years, no funding at all. Just volunteers, because there was no institution who would pay any penny for such studies. When it was published in The Lancet, it was a worldwide boost. It was incredible. It was on the front pages of all papers, Indian Times, Frankfurter Allgemeine, Le Figaro, Le Monde, in the United States, everywhere it was mentioned. Not always well quoted. There were some papers that said the scientists proved the soul, which we didn't. But it's always a problem with journalists, they don't quote well. But mostly, but it is in a scientific world, it was more accepted. near-death experience is still a huge taboo, but it's going better. But also death is a huge taboo in our Western world.
While death might be a taboo subject for many people, returning from death is something that the medical fraternity experiences routinely. Sometimes you have to nearly die to tell a tale that can offer insights into the unknown. Anita Modjani's is one such story. Her extraordinary NDE made her an international sensation. In April 2002, she discovered a lump at the base of her neck.
And I went to the doctor to have it checked, and the doctor conducted a biopsy. And after the biopsy, he confirmed that it was lymphoma, Hodgkin's lymphoma, in fact. And they staged it at what they call staged 1A, but he said it was a little more than 1A, close to 2A, which means it was like just a little past the early stages.
Over the following years, despite trying all kinds and modalities of treatments, the cancer continued to grow throughout her lymphatic system. She developed open skin lesions. She had tumors the size of lemons from the base of her neck to her lower abdomen. On February the 2nd, 2006, 4 years after she had been diagnosed with cancer, Anita did not wake up. The doctors declared that these were her final hours and that her organs had now begun to shut down.
I met with Anita's doctor later that evening when he came in. And at that time, he said to me that Anita's probably not going to make it through the night. And he went off and continued his rounds. And he said he'd come back and see me in the morning. He really didn't expect Anita to be there in the morning. But as Anita lay there through the evening, I made it an absolute point. The nurses weren't doing this, but I made it an absolute point of to stay awake and to watch the three things that I knew to watch. And one was her oxygen uptake, and one was to watch was her blood pressure, and one to watch was her pulse. So I spent the entire evening just watching these three dials.
As the night progressed, the oxygen saturation dropped to decisively dangerous levels. Anita was now slipping away, and Danny just sat there watching her die. Even as Anita lay there, literally on her deathbed, in some ways, she was more alive than ever. It is usually in just such life-threatening situations that a person experiences an NDE.
Near-death experiences can occur during a life-threatening event where physical compromise is so severe that there's loss of consciousness.
Many circumstances where near-death experiences are reported. For a scientific point of view, we needed a cardiac arrest patients because, first of all, you can do a prospective study in cardiac arrest patients. Secondly, we know that in cardiac arrest, the brain doesn't function at all. So this is scientifically important. But there are also near-death experiences reported during surgery, during coma because of a traffic accident, or coma due to an intracerebral hemorrhage. You can have it near drowning in children. You can have it in loss of blood for young women during or after delivery. You can have it also in diseases not immediately life-threatening, but you still can have these kind of experiences. But also in other circumstances, you can have this same kind of experiences in isolation, shipwrecks, astronauts, lost in the desert. You can have it in meditation, the same kind of experience. You can have it in just walking in nature. You could have it in existential crisis or depression, the same kind of experiences. So when you talk about cardiac arrest patients, you talk about near-death experiences. But in other circumstances, you can also say an experience of oneness or mystical experience of religious experiences. It all has been reported before. So you need a non-functioning brain to report an NDE.
In the prospective study conducted by Dr. Lommel, out of the 344 patients, 18% of them reported undergoing near-death experiences during the period of cardiac arrest and cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Research shows that NDEs due to accidents are most common. One typical accident-related NDE case is that of Atul Deshpande, But it was no ordinary auto accident.
I joined the Air Force in 91, and I went into the fighter stream. I flew MiG-21s, then I flew MiG-27s, and I flew them for about 8 years, till I had my accident.
Atul, a fighter pilot in the Sea Flying Squadron of the Indian Air Force, had an NDE when, during a routine sortie, his combat jet spun out of control due to technical failure, and he was forced to eject out of the plane. No amount of training that he had gone through prepared him for the real experience.
There are a lot of checks and balances, and a lot of effort goes into ensuring that you are prepared or you have logically thought through everything that can go wrong, including the experience of dropping us from a helicopter into a lake, so that you know you have gone through almost everything. But it's a logical and it's a mind interpreted thing. It is not an experience. The experience of an air accident or an experience of something is something that you live through. It's just that you have prepared for it, but you are experiencing it first time.
On the 8th of September 1998, Atul was not supposed to fly. He was called in to replace a sick pilot. Reluctantly, Atul agreed to carry out the routine sortie that he had done a number of times before.
I was supposed to drop a bomb on a range. Generally in the Air Force you have these ranges where you go practice bombing, so that in case of an eventuality, in case you're going into war, you have practiced how to drop a bomb. So that is what I was supposed to do that day. There was nothing out of the blue, or it was just a normal routine sortie that I would have done so many times before in my life. It was just you go over a range, standard procedures are there. I had one more person. Fighter aircraft tend to fly in groups, so we were two of us together. I was the lead for that mission, and we were supposed to drop our bombs and come back and land. I went, flew in, I rolled into the dive. Everything was beautiful. You had to drop at a certain height. So I said, okay, the height was coming. I pressed the trigger and I pulled out. And just as I was coming to the horizon, the aircraft yawed. Now, a fighter class of aircraft doesn't yaw, especially at those speeds. And that's where everything kind of changed, because we have onboard computers, and the yaw lasted 125 milliseconds. But I remember my legs moving, trying to counter the yaw with the rudder. And even today, so many years down the line, I remember vividly that moment of yaw. I can see it. And then the aircraft flicked and went into a spin.
Right at that point, Atul left his body. And from a point outside, he perceived his body ejecting out of the plane. He remembers vividly that he did not take the decision to pull the ejection lever.
I do not have any conscious memory of taking the decision to eject. Now, as a pilot, you're trained to eject. So you know that sometime you have to take the decision to eject, and you're supposed to tighten your straps so that the ejection is also safe. So there has to be a process where you decide, yes, no, things are out of control, I need to get out of this aircraft. My memory is pretty sharp, because I remember the 125 milliseconds, but I don't remember taking the decision to eject. I always wonder, if I didn't, then who? So this is a paradox that I have not been able to resolve, I have not been found a solution to.
What happens in life-threatening situations is often totally unfamiliar, indescribable, and lies outside our normal sphere of experience.
Well, when a person has a close brush with death, either from illness or injury, what we now know from research is that they have about a 1 in 5 chance of having what's typically a lucid experience of an alternate reality. And that alternate reality has two aspects to it. One is material, and that's where the person is perceiving the material world from a position outside of their body. And the other is transmaterial, and that's where the person is perceiving and maybe interacting with environments and entities that are not of the material world.
In both their individual NDEs, Anita and Atul experienced a feeling of peace and fearlessness.
The fear was completely gone. I had lived my life in fear, and especially those 4 years of dealing with cancer. It was like every morning I used to wake up and all I felt was this fear of how am I going to get rid of this cancer in my body. But now, in this realm, it was like the fear was just gone.
Everything was calm, there was no noise. It was peace at a level.
In her NDE, she heard a conversation between her doctor and her husband, in which the doctor was extremely negative in his prognosis of her condition. She saw her younger brother sitting in a plane on his way to meet her, a fact that she was not aware of when she slipped into her coma. Events that were beyond her ability to know.
I was aware of everything that was happening around me. I was aware of things that were even being said outside the room of where I was. I also became aware that my brother was on a flight on a plane from India trying to get to me. And I was aware that he wanted to get to me before I was dying. And I clearly remember feeling that I need to stay alive.
In their NDEs, both Anita and even Atul became aware of another reality, contrary to the physical one that we know.
It was just so blissful and so peaceful. And I felt this incredible lightness, just very, very light. And the pain was gone. And I just never felt so beautiful before. I just never recall ever feeling that. And also the love that I felt. For the first time, I felt like I was loved just unconditionally, just because I existed.
It was really beautiful. It was one of the most beautiful sights I've seen in my life. And I could see my cross spinning like an autumn leaf. It was really beautiful. Everything was calm. There was no noise. It was peace at a level. And I could just see the aircraft fall like autumn leaf, and then it dropped and it burst into flames.
For many people, the overwhelming feeling of peace, joy and bliss constitutes the most remembered element of their experience. The intense pain of the trauma is suddenly completely gone.
And a lot can happen during that period where the person typically feels absolutely peaceful and calm. The person typically has a 360-degree global vision. They also can both see and see through solid things like walls. So there's some unusual aspects to their perception in this state. But things typically appear as they normally do, like blue looks like blue, and people are recognizable. But people do sometimes say that in this state, they're not exactly seeing the way they do with physical eyes. It's more like they're perceiving energy patterns.
But not all NDEs are pleasant, peaceful, or calming.
About 15% of the patients with a positive near-death experience have a frightening period when they are in dark room.
To their horror, they sometimes find themselves pulled deeper into darkness. The experience is devoid of positive emotions and later stirs profound feelings of guilt.
It's dark, it's frightening, and then they see the small light, they're attracted to it, and they describe it as a tunnel. But perhaps only 1 or 2% of those people go down in this dark room, and they have experiences like what is written by Dante in the Hell, yeah? Divina Commedia, Divine Comedy. And he must have had an NDE as well, Dante, because he can describe exactly what people can perceive in this hellish environment. When they come back, they are feeling guilt that they were there because of Christianity, because of the church.
Terrifying NDEs may produce long-lasting emotional trauma, but coming to terms with this experience may eventually bring a positive change. An important element of the NDE is the out-of-body experience, or OBE. The OBE begins with a patient's sensation of consciousness leaving the physical body, accompanied by some fear, and followed by an attempt to return to the body. They often feel liberated and amazed at the sight of their lifeless or seriously damaged body. The most common vantage point is from the ceiling, and because of this unusual position, some people initially fail to recognize their body. They experience their new weightless body as a spiritual or non-physical body that can penetrate solid structures. It is impossible for them to communicate or touch others who are present. To their utter amazement, they go unnoticed, even though they can see and hear everything. OBE is of scientific importance because doctors, nursing staff, and relatives can verify the reported events as narrated by the experiencer.
One of the most famous cases is also from our study. Well, the 44 years old man who was found in a meadow by some passers-by, and they didn't really start a resuscitation. They did some pressing before the ambulance came.
After admission to the coronary unit, he received artificial respiration with a balloon and a mask, as well as heart massage and defibrillation. While intubating the patient, the nurse discovered that the patient was wearing dentures in his mouth. The nurse removed the upper denture and put them on a crash cart. After approximately 90 minutes, the patient had sufficient heart rhythm and blood pressure, but he was still in a deep coma.
He was in coma for 1 week. Then he regained consciousness and was transferred back to the cardiac ward. He was just there, then the nurse came in for medication, and he saw the nurse and said, "You were the one who took out my dentures. You know where my dentures are." And he couldn't explain exactly what had happened. He couldn't explain the small room where he had been resuscitated. He came in coma without any breathing, without any blood pressure. Deep, deep coma. He couldn't describe the appearances like the doctors and the nurses, also the nurse who were there. And he said he had seen everything from a position out and above his body. He could describe details were impossible to see from the position where he was lying. And he was very impressed with it. The nurse was impressed as well, because the nurse knew that this all happened when this patient was in deep coma and in the course of resuscitation. So that's another proof that you don't see with your eyes at this very moment, because you're not in your body.
Interestingly, among the reported cases of NDEs, there are numerous cases of blind people seeing and deaf people hearing.
People that are blind include even those born totally blind have described highly visual near-death experiences. I interviewed a lady named Vicky who was born totally blind.
In 1951, Vicky was born extremely prematurely after a pregnancy of only 22 weeks. She was immediately placed in a very primitive incubator and administered 100% oxygen. Such a high concentration of oxygen led to complete damage of her eyeball and optic nerve. Vicky's much-publicized NDE has been a subject of debate among skeptics and researchers alike. She was hurled out of her car in a traffic accident in 1973 and suffered multiple fractures to her basal skull and severe concussions, which left her in a coma. That is when she experienced an NDE.
When you're born totally blind, vision is unknown and unknowable. You simply cannot explain vision to somebody born totally blind in terms of the remaining four senses. It's impossible. Vicky had a bad auto accident when she was in her early 20s, and the first time in her life that she saw herself was when she had a near-death experience in the hospital emergency room.
In the emergency room, she was able to see from a position above her body.
There, above her body, she was immediately horrified. Vision was new and unfamiliar, and something she simply had no prior life experience with. But only when she calmed down did she become aware that that body down below her was her. She was able to correlate the feel of her long hair, and interestingly, the feel of a ring that her father had given her, which she'd only known during her whole prior life by a sense of feel. Now, she was able to see it with vision and understand indeed that was her down below, and that was the beginning of her very detailed, if you will, typical near-death experience.
Could Vicky's observations have been a figment of the imagination? Without a functioning cerebral cortex or any sensory perception, it's difficult to see how.
Blind people from birth who even don't have pictures in their dreams can have perception from a position out and above the body during NDE. For the first time, they have perception. People who can't hear know what is said. It's a kind of thought transfer. It's not hearing, but they know, because when you say something, you first think it. So they know the thoughts of people.
Such cases are forcing scientists to consider new ideas about the relationship between consciousness and the brain.
With our current concepts, you cannot explain near-death experiences, so we have to change our concepts. And I think that was the challenge based on this scientific prospective studies on near-death experience, to discuss again how consciousness is related to brain function. And when we ask ourselves, where am I during sleep? Where is my consciousness during sleep? Or how is it possible that people in deep coma can explain later when they regain consciousness that they know exactly who were there, how they were looking, what was said, which family members were visiting them during coma? They could see in and around ICU, or the rest of the hospital, they could perceive. How is it possible that people during general anesthesia, during surgery, mostly during complications of the operation, can have perception out and above the body, know what is happening, know what the surgeon said or thought, even thought? How is it possible that people in cardiac arrest, where the brain doesn't function at all, can have this enhanced consciousness? So we know the facts, and these facts doesn't fit with the current neuroscientific ideas we have. So we have to change these concepts as well.
These cases of blind people who during near-death experience are able to perceive their surroundings and even see mentally their own body suggests that there are other ways of perceiving. And this has been called by the psychologist who investigated these cases of blind people, Kenneth Ring. He called that mind sight. So it's a form of perception that is mental, because in that kind of state, especially if there's a cardiac arrest, the perceptual system, the visual system, for instance, of the patients, the experiencers, was not functioning, which means that it's possible to have access to perceive the world and ourselves, but using something that doesn't have anything to do with the nervous system.
Occasionally, a patient waking from coma may report an exceptionally clear consciousness during coma. Despite a total absence of demonstrable brain activity, patients talk about having lucid thoughts, memories, emotions, a sense of identity, and verifiable perceptions from out and above their body. It's not only the blind and deaf, but people across all age groups that have reported experiencing an NDE. NDEs have been reported in young children and later verified.
Children's NDEs are especially interesting because they have not been exposed to culture as much. So supposedly their experiences are purer, less contaminated, so to speak, by expectations and so forth. And interestingly, research shows that they have a lot of the same features as adults' near-death experiences and a lot of the same after effects.
Whether it's children, young adults, or grown-ups, the NDE elements unfold with amazing consistency.
All of us people investigating near-death experiences see the same pattern of elements. Consciousness separates from the body and goes over the body. From that vantage point, they can see ongoing earthly events, which may include their own frantic resuscitation efforts. After that, they may go into or through a tunnel. Often at the end of the tunnel is a beautiful, mystical, unearthly light. And then once they pass into that area of light, they may be in unearthly landscapes. Often they're described as being beautiful without any comparison on Earth. There may be colors there that are so beautiful that they don't even exist on Earth. They may hear music so lovely that it is beyond anything possible on Earth. In these unearthly realms, they may have what's called a life review, where they see part of their prior life. They may see their deceased loved ones. They may have joyous reunions that people they knew on Earth who died.
I became aware of my father who had died 10 years prior to this experience. And it was like he was there to greet me. I had lost my best friend. She was like a sister to me. I had lost her 2 years prior to cancer. I encountered her in the other realm. And again, all I felt from her was absolute unconditional love. And I had missed her so much in these last 2 years.
Finally, Anita reached a point in this other reality where she had to make a choice whether to return to her physical body or continue on in that realm.
I really didn't want to come back. I just didn't want to come back because it was so incredible on the other side. And my body was so sick. I couldn't see any good reason to come back. Not only was I suffering in that body, but even my family was suffering.
In a moment of clarity, Anita understood that if she were to make the decision to come back to her physical body, then the body would heal itself of the cancer.
Now that I knew what I knew, that if I chose to go back into my body, my body would just heal. The cancer would heal very quickly. I just knew that.
When people experience deceased loved ones, spiritual entities, they usually, I would say, almost always say that communication is mind to mind, that there's no intercession of language. Sometimes people do report hearing language, but that's the exception.
People often see part of their life that is yet to come.
Sometimes a flash forward is a preview of someone's life. Then they come to a border, and they know at that moment that if I cross this border, I will never come back, and then they hear a voice, or they're instructed, you have to go back, there's not a task to fulfill, and then they can come consciously back into their body, which is awful for them because you're back in this sick body again with all the limitations.
Anita's realization that her decision to go back to her physical body would cause it to self-heal came true. She came back and surprised everyone.
As I started to open my eyes, one of the first people I saw was my brother. He had arrived in Hong Kong and his suitcase was right behind him. He'd come to the hospital straight from the airport. And I smiled at him, and in fact, my family then gathered around me, my husband, my mom, and they were all smiling because they were really surprised that I was coming out of the coma. They were actually quite thrilled.
In comparison, Atul's NDE was a short one. He came back to his body even before his parachute touched down.
And then I started descending with the parachute, and I said, now I'm going to go into the fire. And I said, no, what do I do with this? Suddenly, I don't know from where, one gust of wind came and I kind of landed about 100 meters away from the aircraft. And I ran because the aircraft was exploding. I was very close to it. So I ran for about 100, 150 meters and I hid behind some boulders. The helicopter came, they picked me up. I walked about 200 meters, 300 meters till there and I lay down. After that, for 7 days, I just couldn't get up.
Whatever the duration of an NDE, in both cases, time seems to have lost its meaning.
Time is so strange in the other realm. It was almost like within that instant that I had actually decided I didn't want to come back, it was like I entered another state, which was a state of incredible clarity. And in that moment, I felt as though I understood everything. I understood why my life was the way it was. I understood how every decision that I had made in every moment in time of my life had led up to that point of me dying on that hospital bed.
Time had almost stood still. So that was the kind of feeling or that's the kind of memory that I have. And these memories are really vivid and I can still recollect them.
In near-death experiences, people say that time really loses meaning. It does not exist in that experience the way it exists in material existence. But there's this paradoxical thing where at the same time that they say that everything happened at once, they also say that things did happen in a kind of a sequence. So this is just one of the many paradoxes that makes these experiences really difficult to understand from our perspective in the material world.
Over the next few days, Anita's story started to come out as she started talking about her experience. Although still very sick physically, Anita felt euphoric after her NDE.
When the doctor came in about 3 or 4 days later and he felt that the tumors had gone down by about 70%, he was really, really like in total shock and surprise. He didn't even know what to write in my medical records, and he actually said that. He said, your case is amazing. I don't even know what to put in your medical records. And it was almost as though he made the gesture that he wanted to throw my records into the bin, as though he doesn't even know how to move forward from here. So he thought the best thing to do now was to just keep running more tests to see where my body was at in terms of the cancer.
I think what's also remarkable about Anita and her incredible healing following her near-death experience is that we've seen other people that have had near-death experiences that had astounding and from time to time, in my opinion, medically inexplainable healing. It really makes you wonder about some of these things that go on in near-death experiences. In fact, sometimes people are aware during their near-death experience that they're going to come back healed or will recover rapidly, and almost invariably that's actually what happens.
Atul's recovery played out a little differently, but with an amazingly similar conclusion. At first, his injuries were not apparent, but as they started to surface over a span of almost 2 years, the doctors declared that he would live a highly handicapped life and that he would be unable ever to lift more than 2 kilos of weight.
So at the end of 2 years, they knew exactly what all was wrong. I had a lot of L1, L2, L3, L4, L5, had problems there. Had some problem in D1, D2, had a burst fracture, I had some damage in the disc, I had about 3 discs were damaged between L1 and L5, I don't remember now where. And that said that I can't lift more than 2 kgs of weight, and they said my life will be downhill from there, so they said we wish you luck, and they said smile whatever happens. But thank God they said smile, because I smiled and everything changed. Today I can lift about 22 kgs.
In both cases, the doctors were astonished and refused to acknowledge something that medical science could not explain.
It's such a problem for most physicians to accept that there is a kind of spontaneous healing. There are no publications about spontaneous healing because you need more cases to do statistical analysis, and the problem is these kind of cases are never collected together.
What is it that astounds the medical fraternity? Skeptics put forward various physiological and psychological theories to explain the phenomenon of NDE. Many scientists assume that an NDE is caused by oxygen deficiency in the brain. Others believe psychological reactions, such as fear of death, play a role. Although NDEs occur in extremely diverse circumstances, they are most frequently reported after severe impairment of brain function.
Well, there have been a lot of explanations, especially in the time that there were just retrospective studies. People thought it is due to anoxia, lack of oxygen in the brain. It is the end of the functioning of the brain, and will you get all kind of strange aspects of your consciousness. But we know now by these prospective studies that the brain doesn't function at all. It's not in the first or last seconds of unconsciousness. It's in the middle of the period when there are no brain stem reflexes, no body reflexes, nothing except the EEG is flatline. So it cannot be anoxia of the brain. Then you have a side effect of medication. We found in our study that whatever medication they got did make any difference. When you are in coma for 3 weeks and artificial respiration, you have a lot of medication, did matter at all. Or for other people who regained consciousness within 5 minutes. So also the side effect of medication we could exclude.
Since the beginning of NDE research, there have been repeated claims that an NDE is an hallucination. Could NDEs be mere hallucinations?
The answer, absolutely no. Reason is a hallucination is an unreal, that's why it's called hallucinatory experience. And yet, when you look at near-death experiences, when they have that out-of-body experience and can see ongoing earthly events, and about 45% of near-death experiences describe this, in that out-of-body experience, what they're seeing of ongoing earthly events, even if it's geographically far from their physical body, is almost always absolutely accurate, even down to the finest detail. They're absolutely not hallucinatory or unreal experiences.
Some psychologists maintain that the content of an OBE is simply a combination of memories, fantasies, lucky guesses, and expectations.
There are some skeptical arguments that basically say what they saw when they had an out-of-body experience was a lucky guess. They had that gap of unconsciousness, and then the memory just simply recreated what they thought would have happened. That would make sense if their out-of-body observations during a near-death experience were very often wrong or unreal, and you almost never see that. We've had people that have coded, if you will, in the operating room, had their consciousness leave their body and go to the hospital cafeteria where they can see and hear what their family members are talking about, where they're far away in the hospital, coded and under a general anesthesia. And yet, in that example, what the near-death experiencer saw and heard was later confirmed as absolutely accurate. That is impossible for that to be a fragment of memory or a lucky guess. And there are literally scores of near-death experiences all finding the same thing. Even if the out-of-body observations are far, far from the physical body, far from any possible sensory awareness, what they see and what they hear, when they go back to verify it later, is essentially always accurate, even down to the finest details.
It has also been alleged that NDEers tell deliberate lies to look interesting or to impress others.
I never met a person who tried to fraud me, because the moment you see a person and try to find words for such an emotional experience, you know it's true. I've never met a person who tried to fraud me. Never, never. And that's enough. I think, why should someone try? I don't understand why should someone try to fraud me. So I never met a person who tried. It's just a theoretically approach by the skeptics.
Within 5 weeks of her NDE, Anita was discharged from the hospital.
In total, I was in the hospital for 5 weeks after the near-death experience. And although my body felt physical pain while I was still recovering, because they were doing biopsies and tests, and also because they were constantly injecting me with different things, with drugs and all kinds of things. So I did feel pain, I did feel reaction, but inside of me, I knew that I was going to be fine.
For Atul, the road to recovery took almost 10 years.
First time I could sit up without a backrest was 2008. So it was about a decade between 98 to 2008.
Being conscious and alive, even at the time when their bodies were almost dead, changed Anita and Atul forever. Like most NDEers, they developed a more compassionate and calm demeanor.
And so people come away from the life review often with a sense of that our lives have purpose and that the purpose is to advance in our capacity to love and to treat other people in loving ways.
I really noticed that I had become a dramatically different person. I had different understanding of life than what I used to have prior to my near-death experience. I used to live in fear. I used to always work hard at being something, at doing something. I always worked hard at being liked, at making friends. Now, all those feelings of needing to do anything were gone because there was a realization that all I had to do was be myself. I realized that I am a spiritual being no matter what I do. We all are. We're spiritual whether we realize it or not.
I have become more spiritual. Although I may not be able to define what is spirituality, but compassion, yes. There's a lot of charity that I do, and it is not the charity that gives you a tax refund. It is a kind of charity where the left hand doesn't know what the right is doing. I've really gone out, helped people, changed people's lives, and this is just because I thought it is my... I will not even say it's a duty. I just knew I had to do it, so I did it. That's all. I will not say it is compassion. I would just say that you just think that everything is, what else is there to do? This is what you're here to do anyway. So it's that kind of a frame of mind.
Anita and Atul now continue to live their lives with the knowledge that the death of the body is not the end of a person. Their experience suggests that consciousness can and may exist even without the body.
Well, the main conclusion from study of near-death experience in patients who survive cardiac arrest is that it is not possible to accept current never proven hypothesis that consciousness is a product of brain function, because the brain doesn't function anymore and people have an enhanced consciousness. This, the different approach must be that there's a continuity of consciousness, that death like birth is just an altered state of consciousness. It's always there. Consciousness, there's no beginning to consciousness, and consciousness never comes to an end.
It often takes an NDE to get people to think about the possibility of experiencing consciousness outside of the body, and to consider that consciousness, or the source of consciousness, always has been and will be. Could it be that this source of consciousness, that we may call the soul, will exist forever, and death, as such, does not exist? Is it possible for consciousness to return in a new body? The soul should not only be able to exist separate from the body, but also be able to move from one body to another. Is there any evidence of this? Join us next time as we dive even deeper to unravel the mystery of reincarnation in our exploration of past life memories.